Borthakur IAS Academy, an endeavor of excellence.
Borthakur IAS Academy.
Hello everyone, welcome to Borthakur's IAS Academy, Northeast's premier institute for UPSC, APSC and NPSC preparations. I'm your friend Atrey, and today I'm here with another segment of Current Affairs 365, dated 1st of June 2021. This is your one-stop solution for any news and updates which will help you to prepare for your civil services examination, and along with that, it is beneficial for any other government exam. Don't forget to like and share this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can also follow us on Facebook as well as Instagram. So now, without any further ado, let's get started. So the first news of the day is regarding Horticulture Cluster Development Program, which will be tagged under the GS Paper 2. And it will be included in the subtopic of government policies and intervention, and can also be included in agriculture part. Okay. So recently, the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, they launched the Horticulture Cluster Development Program in order to promote the export of horticultural produce of our country. Horticulture, we all know, it is the branch of plant agriculture which deals mainly with the garden crops like fruits, vegetables, and some other ornamental plants. Now, coming to Cluster Development Program, it is a central sector program which mainly aims at growing and developing some identified horticulture clusters in order to make them globally competitive. And horticulture clusters, these are geographical or regional concentration of some targeted crops. Okay. This particular program, it will be implemented by the National Horticulture Board, which is under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. In a pilot phase here, the program will be implemented in 12 horticultural clusters out of the total 53 selected clusters for this particular program. And all these clusters, it will be implemented through the cluster development agencies that are appointed on the recommendations of each state and union territory government. The main objective of this particular program is to address all the major issues that are related to our Indian horticulture sector, which includes pre-production, production, post-harvest management, logistics, marketing, as well as branding. It will also aim at providing geographical specialization and promoting integrated and market-led development of these horticultural clusters. This program is expected to benefit around 10 lakh farmers, and also it will attract an investment worth rupees around 10,000 crore when implemented in all the 53 clusters. Okay, so now if we have a look at the horticulture sector of our country, then we know that India is the second largest producer of horticulture crops globally, and India is a leading country in producing fruits like mango, banana, pomegranate, acid lime, etc. In the year 2018 and 19, Andhra Pradesh, followed by Maharashtra and UP, were the top fruit producing states, and West Bengal, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh, they were the top states in vegetable production. Some of the recent steps which are taken in order to uplift the horticulture sector of our nation, it includes the allocation of rupees 2250 crore for the year 2021-22. For the Mission for Integrated Development of Horticulture. This mission, it is a centrally sponsored scheme for holistic growth of horticultural sector, covering the fruits, vegetables, root and tuber crops, including mushrooms, spices, flowers, aromatic plants, etc. There is a tremendous scope for enhancing the productivity of Indian horticulture, which is imperative in order to cater to our country's estimated demand of around 650 million tons of fruits and vegetables by the year 2050. There are some new initiatives like focus on planting material production, cluster development program and credit push through agri infra fund, etc., that are the right steps which are being taken in this particular direction. The second news is about the announcement made by government on extension of pension coverage and insurance benefits for families of those people who died due to COVID-19. And this pension coverage, it will be extended under the Employees State Insurance Corporation of India scheme, which will, and those people, they will get benefit under the EDLI, Employees Deposit Linked Insurance Scheme, and also under Employees Provident Fund Organization, EPFO. So first of all, What is this ESIC scheme? What are the benefits that are included under this scheme? All the dependent family members of such person who died of COVID, they will be eligible for a pension equivalent to 90% of the average daily wage, which was drawn by the worker as per the existing rule. And this particular benefit, it will be available from 24th of March 2020 till 24th of March 2022. However, there are some eligibility condition, okay, in order to avail the benefits under this particular scheme. It is that the insured person, he must have been registered on the ESIC online portal at least 3 months prior to his death or prior to the diagnosis of the COVID, COVID result. And also that person must have been employed for wages and contributions for at least 78 days. Under the EPFO and EDLI scheme, the maximum insurance benefit that has been increased from rupees 6 lakh to rupees 7 lakh. And the benefits, they are being made available to the families of even those employees who may have changed their jobs in the last 12 months preceding to his or her death. And about 6.53 crore families, they are expected to be eligible to get this benefit under the following scheme. Now, if we have a look at the Employees State Insurance Scheme, then it is actually a multidimensional social system that provides socio-economic protection to all the worker population and their immediate dependent or the immediate family members who are covered under the ESI scheme. And the ESI, it is actually an integrated measure of social insurance, which was embodied under the Employees State Insurance Act of the year 1948. Employees Deposit Linked Insurance, it is an insurance cover which is provided by the EPFO for private sector salaried employees, and it was launched in the year 1976. And any employee who has an EPF account, they automatically becomes eligible for the Employees Deposit Linked Insurance Scheme. Employees Provident Fund Organization is on the other hand, a government organization that manages provident fund and pension accounts for the workforce who are engaged in the organized sector of our country. And it implements the Employees Provident Fund and Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1952. This particular organization, it is administered by the Ministry of Labor and Employment under Government of India. The third news is about the OPV, Offshore Patrol Vessel Sajag, that got commissioned into the Indian Coast Guard. So this OPV, it is the third out of the five indigenously designed OPV and has been built by the Goa Shipyard Limited. This was built under the Make in India policy. The other four OPVs, that is Offshore Patrol Vessel, they are the Saksham, Sachet, Sujit and the Sarthak. Okay. And all these OPVs, they are fitted with advanced technology equipments, including Sajag, and the weapons and sensors are capable of carrying a twin-engine helicopter along with four high-speed boats. The OPVs, what are they? They are some long-range surface ships, okay, which are mainly capable of coastal and offshore patrolling, policing the maritime zones. They conduct some control and surveillance activities there, and are also involved in anti-smuggling and anti-piracy operations with some limited wartime roles also. The OPV Sajag, it will help to manage the greater responsibilities in the years to come, and in turn will strengthen ICG's concurrent multiple operations capability. This they will be working towards ensuring safe, secure and clean seas, as also responding promptly to any maritime emergency in the neighborhood. Now, the Indian Coast Guard, we all know that it is an armed force and also a search and rescue and maritime law enforcement agency that works under the Ministry of Defense. And the Indian Coast Guard, it actually has a wide range of task capabilities for both the surface and air operations. It is one of the largest coast guards in the entire world. Indian Coast Guard, it was established on 18th August 1978 by the Coast Guard Act of 1978. And it performs many non-military functions also. The main concept of forming ICG, it came into being after the 1971 war. And the blueprint for a multidimensional coast guard, it was first conceived by the visionary Rustamji committee. This the headquarters of ICG, it is at located at New Delhi, and the organization is being headed by the Director General, Indian Coast Guard. The jurisdiction of Indian Coast Guard includes over the territorial waters of India, including the contiguous zone and also the exclusive economic zones. And the main functions of ICG is that it is responsible for any maritime environment protection in the maritime zones of our country, acts as a coordinating authority for responding to the oil spills in Indian waters, and along with it, it protects India's maritime interests and enforces its maritime laws also. The next news is about cryptocurrency and our country. It is about the increasing significance of cryptocurrencies around the world and why India should now accept it in order to go hand in hand with the world in the upcoming phase of digital revolution. We all know that with the creation of Bitcoin in 2008 and till the present date, cryptocurrencies, they have gained much significance all around the world. And specifically, the gains made by this sector since the onset of COVID-19 in January 2020, these are actually astounding because the crypto market, it grew by over 500%. However, in the 2018-19 budget speech, our finance minister announced that the government, it does not consider cryptocurrencies as legal tender. Also, we'll have to consider this fact that India has always been a late adopter in the previous phases of digital revolution. But now there is a need for a change in the thoughts and outlooks, and also for acceptance for these virtual currency, as India will now mark its first step towards entering the new phase of digital revolution. Now, if we look back, then the pioneer cryptocurrency, which is Bitcoin, okay, it traded initially at a very low rate in 2010, but gradually it commanded a market price of worth $65,000 as of April 2021. Later, many newer coins, newer cryptocurrencies, they were also introduced, and their cumulative market value, it touched $2.5 trillion by May 2021. So the significance of cryptocurrencies, they can actually be explained under the following points. First is helping in keeping corruption in check. This is mainly done by tracking the flow of funds and transactions. Secondly, it is time effective because cryptocurrencies, they can help save a lot of time as well as money for both the remitter and the receiver. Thirdly, it is cost effective as the intermediaries such as banks, credit card and payment gateways, they draw almost 3% of the total global economic output as fees for their services. But integrating blockchain into these sectors, it could result in hundreds of billions of dollars in savings, right? So these are the ways in which cryptocurrency can actually help boost the economy of any nation, right? So now coming to the scenario of cryptocurrencies in our country, in the year 2018, the RBI, it issued a circular which prevented all the banks from dealing in cryptocurrencies. However, this circular, it was declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court in May 2020. Recently, our government, it has announced a bill, okay, it has announced to introduce a bill titled Cryptocurrency and Regulation of Official Digital Currency Bill of 2021. This has mainly been done to create a sovereign digital currency, and simultaneously it will ban all the private cryptocurrencies. The next news is about the World No Tobacco Day. Every year, the World Health Organization and its global partners, they celebrate the World No Tobacco Day on 31st of May. And this year's theme for World No Tobacco Day was Commit to Quit. The World Health Organization has also honored Indian Union Health Minister Harshvardhan with Director General's Special Award for his efforts to control tobacco consumption in India. His leadership was instrumental in the 2019 national legislation to ban e-cigarettes and heated tobacco products. Now, if we have a look at the socio-economic burden of tobacco in our country, then we can see that in India, over 1.3 million deaths are attributable to tobacco use every year. This means that around 3,500 deaths per day occur because of tobacco use. This imposes a lot of avoidable socio-economic burden of tobacco in our country. In addition to the death and diseases, tobacco also has a negative impact on the economic development of our country. the smokers, they face a 40 to 50% higher risk of developing severe disease deaths from COVID-19. Now, if we take a look at the measures towards tobacco control in our country, then we can see that India adopted the tobacco control provisions under World Health Organization's Framework Convention on Tobacco Control, which is WHO-FCTC. Also, we will have to make a mention of the Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act of 2003, which replaced the Cigarettes Act of 1975. Then we have the promulgation of the Prohibition of Electronic Cigarettes Ordinance of 2019. It prohibits production, manufacture, import, export, distribution, storage and advertisement of e-cigarettes. Along with that, we have the National Tobacco Quitline Service. This tobacco quitline services, they have the potential to reach a large population of tobacco users with the sole objective to provide telephonic information, advice, support and referrals for tobacco cessation. So with this, we have come to an end of today's session. I hope you liked this video and this was useful for you all. I'll see you all again tomorrow with another session of Current Affairs 365, only on Bothakur's IAS Academy, Northeast's premier institute for UPSC, APSC and NPSC preparations. Don't forget to like and share this video and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bothakur IAS Academy. প্রস্তুতি আৰু অধ্যয়নৰ নিৰ্ভৰযোগ্য ঠিকনা বৰঠাকুৰ আইএএছ একাডেমী।